Welcome back to part two of the Funny Indian Show podcast, aka the Tangent Show.
We're back. Do you guys want to know what Rajiv was doing during this break?
During the intro.
I feel like you guys have no idea. It could have been a half an hour. It could have been an hour. It could be the next day.
That's true.
We have no idea.
We have no idea what the time left was.
No, you can tell. No, I don't think we should.
Yeah. Okay. We'll leave it open ended. We'll leave it to their imagination, which is something you need to be an actor. So if they can't imagine anything,
yeah, then sorry.
They should give it up. That should be that. So I just saw your movie, Three Veils.
Yes.
In New York at the...
Thank you for coming.
Absolutely. Thanks for having us. The New York International Film Festival, mm-hmm. Tribeca, right?
In Tribeca.
So I had seen your earlier work, Looking for Comedy in the Muslim World.
A little different from that.
And I saw you were talking about growth. I mean, I thought you were excellent in... Looking for Comedy in the Muslim World, but I did see the growth, and I did how you were perfecting your craft.
Thank you.
Which is a good thing. So, yeah, talk a little bit about what this movie meant to you. Maybe set it up a little. We're not going to play a clip, but
no.
You know, I enjoyed it. But tell me what...
Thank you. No, I mean, for me, this movie, I mean, it's about three Middle Eastern women mm-hmm. living in the U.S., mm-hmm. each kind of going through their own struggle, very sure. specific to them and different than all three. And for me, you know, I read the script... I get a lot of, because I've done so many independent films.
Sure.
So I do get a lot that I read, and I do read all of them. And this was one of those ones that I read and got goosebumps the minute I started.
That's great.
And I thought, oh, well, that's different. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. And I read, I weeped. Mm-hmm. I mean, I was crying at several parts when I read mm-hmm. the script, and immediately was so connected and taken in by Nikki that...
Nikki's the character I play,
mm-hmm. and she is dealing with a lot of demons, more so than the other characters in that she's had a troubled childhood mm-hmm. and has been, you know, she's an alcoholic and she has a lot of tragedy in her family that she's, I don't want to give it away, that she's
sure.
been working through and really lost mm-hmm. and really has no, you know, real love in her life in mm-hmm. any way, shape, or form and, you know, kind of finding her way
sure.
and making bad decision after bad decision mm-hmm. in the process.
And that's what kind of led to some of the comedy, too, because it was poignant yet funny.
I'm glad you said that mm-hmm. because, you know, mm-hmm. I said to the director, I said, for me, when we were talking about doing the movie, I said, I find there's so much humor here. She said, you do? Mm-hmm. I said, I do. I said,
absolutely.
I know it sounds crazy. I said, but that's how you get through stuff.
Mm-hmm.
I said, and I would love to try to... I mean, in any scene, mm-hmm. you've got to find the funny. And whether
right.
you play it or you don't is another story, whatever choice you make. But you got to play with it.
Right.
And I feel like someone like Nikki would be the first one to make a joke to try to get over something.
Mm-hmm.
And I feel like I tried really hard, so I'm glad you got that mm-hmm. because I really wanted to bring comedy to it. Because otherwise, you can go jump off a bridge after you, you know, see certain things.
Oh, sure.
And so I didn't feel like that's real life. I feel like there's a lot of humor in everything.
Sure.
And I really felt like... But she was thankfully really supportive and said, you know, a lot of people
that's
wouldn't
good.
Have done that or would do that.
Because
yeah,
it's a
that.
Risk. But it's a risk that paid
I'm glad
off.
That, I'm glad that people like
oh,
that.
Oh, it translated. Because,
yeah.
I mean, Schindler's List has comedic moments.
You have to.
You have to have some
have
comic
to.
Relief.
You have to find the levity in every moment. And I think
I completely
as
agree.
An actress, when it comes to, like, say, I don't really, by the way, like to qualify any movie as a drama or a comedy or whatever.
Sure.
Because I think in life, it's all of those things
it's a series
at the same
of moments.
Time. Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
But, that's the first thing I'll do when it comes to a very dramatic thing mm-hmm. is I'm like, where's the levity? Where's the funny?
Right.
Because I need to put that in. Because otherwise we'll play the drama
mm-hmm.
and that's not, I don't find...
Well, then it becomes
honest.
A soap opera.
Yeah, I think it's melodramatic.
Yeah. Very, very, very true.
Yeah.
One of the questions actually, when I kind of paused and then I lost my way one of the times in the first part.
Because I keep cutting you off.
No, it's good. Yeah. That's a conversation. That's good. How long just between... Well, you know, like, I'm a new actor.
Mm-hmm.
I'm someone who, that's why, and I don't really call myself an actor by my own definition, because I feel like to live in Los Angeles, you need, it was like $50,000 a year to live, I think. So I think whenever I make $50,000 doing a certain pursuit, I can call myself that. So I definitely do that in stand-up. And that's not giving anything away, I don't think. I hope people assume that I make at least that. But without giving away what the total income is, I think with acting, there have been some years where, you know, I'm hopefully going to get close to that or whatever else. But I don't hit that number every year. And so I don't call myself an actor.
Mm-hmm.
Although I am enrolled in acting class, I've booked a few commercials.
Mm-hmm.
I have representation, I do all that.
Mm-hmm.
How long before I can expect that I'm going to book things. Because for me personally, it's discouraging at times. Right. Because I go into a stand-up audition and I know I can kill it. I'm like, all right, oh, it's a showcase. I know I can do this. But in acting, I look around the room and I see 20 people who are, you know, look like me. I'm like, how am I going to differentiate myself versus these guys? Mm-hmm. And I know I'm different from them. Mm-hmm. How long before a person reasonably gets to Hollywood, so to speak, can you start to go, okay, you're going to start booking things? Or after a certain number of years, you go, man, you really haven't booked anything? You've been doing this for X number of years?
Well, I don't think, first of all, I would call you an actor by my definition.
I know. Use your definition.
So I actually would. And I think that everything you're doing is right. Mm-hmm. You might be surprised to know that I don't hit 50K every year.
Okay.
So the funny thing is about that is, because of the types of movies I want to do, they're very small movies.
Well, they're independent.
And so, you know, most of them pay an obscene small amount of money that basically you do, because like, it doesn't even cover a month's rent sometimes.
Well, I did a comedy show where the booker handed me, I don't know how much it was at a major comedy club, mm-hmm. I'm not going to say which one, and they handed me an envelope, and I had no idea what was going to be in it. It was a 5 and 3 1. They gave me $8 to perform at this great room. And I remember thinking, I would rather you charge me $8. It's more respectful than giving me that I have to sign for, and you're handing it to me like it's, you know, mafia money.
Yeah.
And it's $8 to perform at this great room and do a relatively long set.
Sure, you have a skill.
I hope that's worth more than $8.
You would hope, and it is.
And that's why I love to talk numbers, because
that's what I'm telling you. Is it's like not about So here's the thing. A lot of people would completely disagree with me, just so you know.
No, there's no wrong answer here.
And so the way I have lived my life is I don't want to do something unless I love it. Mm-hmm. And so I have not done a lot of things. I've turned down a large number of films and television that other people have all done and gone on and done very well and made tons of money. And do I look back and think, would I have loved that? Absolutely. Sure. But at the end of the day, I value my time more than anything and mm-hmm. my spirit. And I don't want to put my time and spirit into things I'm not passionate about. Because mm-hmm. I am the way I am, mm-hmm. when I sign on to do something, I'm not just the actor. I mm-hmm. bring in everything. Mm-hmm. And I contribute in lots of ways, which is why I'm a natural producer and why I'm doing that now. Because I want more control at the end of the day.
Sure.
So that is why I kept bartending. Mm-hmm. And honestly, afforded me the opportunity to say, no,
to not take work.
I don't
want to
do that TV show, or I don't want to play that part, or I don't want to do that movie because I have nothing that I have to offer there. It's not going to challenge. It's not going to be. I mean, by the way, if it had come to me in a different part of my life, I might have had a different reaction, which is in everything. Sure. But
can you give an example without necessarily naming the role? And you can if you want to, or the person if you want to, but not necessarily. Can you give an example of something you did turn down and why you turned it down?
I mean, I won't give names because I think that's tacky.
But that's why I'm saying you don't
have
to.
Yeah, no, but I will say there's been a lot of television mm-hmm. that I've turned down.
Okay.
And there's been a lot of independent film, and I've done a ton of independent film.
Sure.
But what's funny is, say you do one independent film that seems to hit for some reason, then everyone wants to make 5 other versions of the same thing badly.
Sure.
So then I'll get those, and I'm like, well, I don't know, you know. And they'll all be like, well, we'll give you this, this, and this, and we'll pay you this, this, and this. And the funny thing, it's so hard, and here's the thing, this is why people will disagree with me, is it's so hard for an actor to ever turn down work because there's so little, and paid work is so hard to turn down. And I don't blame anyone for doing anything for mm-hmm. money, whatever, because I get it. Mm-hmm. But that is why some people would choose to be, would say, I'm going to do that, those roles, so that I can then do the stuff
I love.
I chose.
I'll get one for them, one for me.
Right, exactly. Mm-hmm. And by the way, a lot of the movies that I've done, like I said, there have been years where I barely make enough to even cover my expenses. Mm-hmm. And I've had some really lean years, and people, the funniest thing is people think you're living a glamorous life, and you're not.
Yeah.
You know, not with me, not the kind of movies I'm making, you know. And so, you know, you just choose the kind of life you want. And for mm-hmm. me, it's always been about the work. It's always been about wanting to be able to sleep at night, feeling like, look, have I done movies and then seen them and been disappointed? Absolutely. Mm-hmm. There's several movies of mine where I'm like, ugh, which is, again, go back to why I'm producing now.
Sure.
Because I feel like what's that?
Right.
You know, that wasn't the script I read.
Sure.
There's nothing I can do to control that. But I knew when I accepted it that my intentions were pure, and I was really excited at the time to see what it could have been.
Sure.
But then it's out of your hands, you know? So, you know, I think that it's, I honestly think it's, I think perseverance is a big thing. I think constantly, I'm in class still, I still study, I still think it's important to keep getting better at what mm-hmm. you do. I think pushing yourself, I think really being bold about your choices and believing in yourself, mm-hmm. and being like, you know what, I don't have to do this. Mm-hmm. Not that there's anything wrong with it, but if I don't like it, you know, believe that there'll be something else. Or create your mm-hmm. own thing. Mm-hmm. Just create your own thing. Nowadays, there's so many avenues to do your own stuff that there's no excuse to be lazy and not do it.
I say my dream, and a lot of my friends know this, is I want to host the Oscars. That's what I want to do. That's my big, hairy, audacious mm-hmm. goal. That's what I want to do.
But you grew up watching them.
I grew up watching them, so I feel like I could do it. You know, I'm like, come on, I've watched them. That's enough, right? But I also, and I want to be a talk show host. So in this day and age, then be a talk show host. Like, get a podcast
exactly.
and go. Like,
and that
nothing
is impressive
is
to
you.
Me.
Nothing
which is why it's you. Funny when you first reached out to me, mm-hmm. and I know it took a while to like figure it out, sure. but I also was like, good for him.
Sure, thanks.
I support, yeah. I'm like the most support, like I love when people do their own shit,
sure.
you know?
Sure.
I just feel like, you know, that's what we need to support.
No, I think that that's good. Do you, so you've turned down a lot of TV work. Have you chosen to focus more on film?
No, because I've done a lot
feature?
Of TV as well. Okay. I mean, I've also turned down a lot of movies.
Okay.
I mean, I'm just saying the TV, okay. because they generally pay more. Television,
sure.
certainly, especially doing a series,
sure.
is a lot more lucrative than doing one movie.
Of course.
So in terms of the money, I was just saying mm-hmm. that I've turned down a lot of that. But I've also turned down a lot of movies.
Sure.
But not to say that I'm like better than it. I'm just not where I'm at.
But it just
at
wasn't,
the time.
It wasn't, yeah.
It's just not for me. But no, I love TV. And by the way, I would love to do a TV show.
Sure.
That I love. And I just, and I guest star all the time. Mm-hmm. I guest starred on, I mean, I can't remember half the shows I've guest starred, but each one I loved. I'd guest starred on Nip Tuck, loved it. I just mm-hmm. did Royal Pains, which is airing this Wednesday.
This Wednesday, which by the time it drops will be
this,
the
yes.
day before, but yes.
I just did NCIS
sure.
LA.
Mm-hmm.
You know, if it's the right thing, I love it. And I would love to be on a series that I was excited about and
sure.
proud of. And I've been a part of several pilots
sure.
I've done that just didn't make it to air. I did one TV show for NBC mm-hmm. that got picked up,
sure.
reshot because they replaced someone with Lisa Silverstone, had a great cast. We shot six. They didn't even
sure.
air one.
Oh, man.
Yeah, I mean, this is the nature of
that's
the game.
That's the nature of the beast. Absolutely.
You know? So I've done
absolutely.
A lot. It's just they don't seem to make it on air.
Well,
I haven't had the luck. The funny thing
sure.
is with me is I haven't had the luck. I've
sure.
had a tremendous amount of good fortune that I get to do the kind of roles that I want to do because, by the way, I seek them out and people know that that's the kind of stuff I want to do. But I haven't had, like, the luck that I feel like some actors have had being like, wow, they really fell into a great situation.
Sure.
Which is amazing for them.
Sure.
But I haven't had that.
Sure. No.
Yeah.
That's fair. That's fair. So I guess how long, to my original question about how long before I should, quote-unquote, feel bad. I know you call me an actor, so that's good, and I appreciate that. And I think your opinion is actually worth a lot more in this case than mine, since I definitely think you're an actor out of the two of us. Do, like, I mean, how long does it take? I mean, I've got, you know, 9 years of stand-up experience. I've been going to acting class and doing, I would call myself an actor by your definition for the last couple of years. I mean, how long does this take before I can book something, man?
Well, it's one of those things where it's really a numbers game.
Uh-huh.
I mean, it's about the more opportunities that you get in on, at the end of the day, it really is a numbers game. And
sure.
one of my first like agents said that, because I, in the beginning, right, when I first started auditioning, I was like a mess after everyone.
Sure.
And I remember calling my friend, actually everyone probably knows Asif Manvi,
uh-huh, yeah,
one
I know.
Of my oldest best friends.
Sure.
And I remember at the time, after I started auditioning, I would call him and
right.
I'd be like literally crying to him on the phone.
Yeah.
And he said to me, she thought you need to pull it together. He said, you cannot cry every time you don't get a part. You're not going to last for more. And he said to me, which was the best thing at the time, she thought, it can't be about getting the job. It needs to be about going in there and being able to be an amazing actor and being able to do this piece of work that was on the page that you feel very strongly about. And when you leave, you feel like, you know what? I left them. I impinged on them. I moved them in some way. I made them laugh. I made them cry. All of the above. I don't care. But that's what it's about.
Mm-hmm.
And if you get the job, that's gravy.
You know what's interesting? That the most helpful piece of advice, I've heard a lot of great pieces of advice when it comes to acting, and you know, to me it's about intent, arc, and stakes, and I always think of those three things when I go into an audition. But the most important thing I think of is that I don't treat it as an audition, I treat it as a performance.
Mm.
So you get a chance to perform for that day.
Mm-hmm.
You get a chance to act for that day. And whether or not you book the job, so when I'm driving to a lot, I don't go, I'm trying to book the job. I go, I'm acting today.
By the way, I think the art of auditioning is a completely different thing than
it
actually
is.
Doing a movie or a TV show. I think it's a very specific thing that a lot of people aren't good at.
Mm-hmm.
I don't think I'm a very good auditioner
mm-hmm.
because I actually go in there very much like working and playing and doing what I would want to do when I'm working. And by the way, if I was casting, I would want an actor like that.
Sure.
But people who are fantastic, who book all the time are really good at auditioning and know what to leave people with, so they're like, oh. But But then I've heard tons of stories of friends of mine that are writers, producers, directors. They're like, they come on set and they don't know what to do. That's not what I want. I want an actor who can play and who can.
Right.
And so there's a funny disconnect sometimes. And
well,
so that's why experience matters.
Yeah.
That's why you're having done what you've been doing for so long at the end of the day in front of the right person that will value that will matter.
Well, and it's, you know, I learned that by watching tennis. I learned it by watching so many scenarios where, you know, Agassi or Sampras or one of these guys about ready to serve and a bird will fly across the court or a ball boy will drop a ball or somebody will scream out or there'll be an airplane overhead or, you know, these guys have just been there that they can wait, shake it off and go to their second serve, which most people, I mean, a young kid starting out, can't do that.
Exactly.
You need everything, conditions have to be exactly perfect, or you just can't perform.
Right.
And I learned that by watching and observing, okay, they just shook it off, and they did it, and then they did their second serve. Amazing. And they got it in. So, well, I guess what I'm hearing you say, so though, it's almost like with, they say that running for president is, because you love politics too.
Yeah.
What it takes to run for president and win as a campaigner
is a different
skill set from governing.
I agree.
So tell me what it is, what do I need to do to be a good auditioner?
I'm not a very good auditioner. That's what I'm saying.
Sure.
I don't know if I'm the person to ask because I think I'm not very good at it at all, actually. And at the end of the day, like, my struggle with auditioning has also left me, because I've been doing this now, what, for 14 years?
Right.
I kept playing with my head, thinking I should do this, this, and this. And what I learned is that I wasn't being a good actor.
Mm-hmm.
And at the end of the day, you just have to believe, for me, everyone's different, and I'm sure there's people you can ask, what are the tricks, because I don't know them, and maybe I can learn them.
Sure.
But I tried to do the little gimmicky things or whatever, but honestly, you're not a good, in my opinion, I don't find that good acting.
Sure.
And so I was like, Sheetal, you just have to, if nothing else, I want to feel like I left them with the best that I could possibly do, that's the best of me.
Right.
And if they don't want that, they don't want that.
Right.
And you hope that the next one, Well, they'll want that, you know? And so that's, I don't have the answer because I'm not good at it.
Sure.
But I will tell you that trying to be something or trying to do that isn't really what I would recommend.
Mm-hmm.
But I will say be insanely prepared, get focused, keep my phone in the car, don't look at it. Like when you're in the room and you're waiting, bring music, do whatever it takes to keep you in the space. If people are around talking, leave, because people are so weird at these waiting
rooms.
They are. So I just take myself out of the situation. You know, and you just do what you need to do. You know your process, right? So create an environment, even in a waiting room or before you test or whatever, so you can do the best you can.
Right.
You know, whatever that is. But preparation, I think, is the biggest thing, you know, and feeling confident and feeling like you've done it enough that you can now have fun when you go in there.
Mm-hmm.
And I feel like that's what I hope people reward.
Right. No, I agree. Is there a certain technique that you use in acting?
Yes. Well, I mean, they have a whole system of different studios.
Mm-hmm.
And I don't know if you want to get so actory, but they all come from Stanislavski. And so there's Strasberg and Meisner and Adler and all these different wings. And I was in the Strasberg train of training.
Okay.
Which is what people call method acting,
right? Yeah.
And so I did that for years, and then I actually felt like it was an amazing internal place to tap into for a lot of emotion and a lot of just adding depth. But I didn't feel like it was complete for me, and everyone's different. So I ended up going to Amsterdam, and I did a summer with the Experimental Theater Wing. I did a study abroad. And that is an extremely external approach, and it's all very physical. And we had a bunch of teachers that came in for weeks, different weeks at a time, and did workshops with us. And we learned everything from masking to Grotowski to Brecht to Kristen Linklater, I love Shakespeare, who broke down that in a way I had never been taught before.
Mm-hmm.
And really, it was like a complete package for me then, because I got a very physical, external approach to something that I felt, I had an internal thing that I felt confident with.
Sure.
And that kind of put it together. And to be honest, when I came to LA, because I still love studying, I found Milton Katselis here, who passed away, which is heartbreaking for me and anyone who knows anything about acting and real teachers, who honestly put everything together for me in a way that I would never have imagined I needed. And I studied with him for a very long time, and he is... been my, you know, mentor and was my friend, and I'd call him from sets from South Africa to London, whatever, being like, I don't know what to do.
Right.
And he would talk me through, basically, he put confidence in what you already knew, but
right.
I was fortunate enough to be part of his master class, which was an invite-only professional actor working class where we could go and fail and not worry about being judged,
right?
So I was in a class with Doris Roberts and Giovanni Ribisi and Michael Pena and Harry Hamlin and people that are amazing, and directors, Howie Deutsch. It was a director, actor, writer class, so people, directors could work on directing because Milton was the best director ever.
Sure.
Actors could work and writers could put their stuff up, and I will tell you, brilliant class, being able to do scenes with that level, I would come in and just be in awe of what I saw. I did better work in that class, and I think everyone would say who was in that class, than probably we've ever done in our lives.
Right.
Because what we did, the level of what... I got more nervous when I did a scene, because we only did like three, maybe four a day, because he would spend hours with you. And, I mean, I was so much pressure that I would be like, I would want to throw up. I couldn't. I was sweating. I was so nervous. I never got so nervous in my life than I did before I performed in that class.
Oh my gosh.
To this day. And anyone in that class would probably say the same thing.
You were challenged more in the class.
Absolutely.
Than
I've ever been
set.
In. Absolutely.
Wow.
Absolutely.
Wait, and which class is Milton?
Milton Katselas. He started the Beverly Hills Playhouse.
Okay.
And his specific, the one he has a lot of teachers that he ended up prodigying.
Mentoring them. And stuff,
But his class that he taught was the Saturday Master Class, which was a professional invite only, you know, thing. And I was just so fortunate to be a part of
that. That's pretty.
It's hardcore.
Wow.
Hardcore.
That's pretty dope.
Yeah. And he would call you on the fact if you didn't come in prepared.
Uh huh.
I mean,
yeah, that's pretty awesome. I'm nervous just hearing you talk about it. That's really cool.
And it's just nice because I love the theater, and I was trained on the theater and did so much.
Sure.
So to be in the theater, by the way, I don't think anyone can be a real, like, if you want to know what it takes to act, do theater.
Mm-hmm.
So to have that every Saturday of my life, and then he would also, I would bring in stuff that I was working on that he would coach me on, you know. I mean, it was a fantastic place to get ideas and thoughts and run by him.
Sure.
And I would give him scripts of movies I was doing, and he would. I miss him more than I can even explain. To not have him in my life anymore is like, there's so much I want to just talk to him about.
Sure.
Yeah.
Sure.
I have every one of them because he recorded every class for us to have. I have all of my tapes of him that I still listen to because I just want to hear his voice. And every time I hear him critique me, I learn something new, even though I've heard it God knows how many times.
That's amazing. What would you ask him right now if you could ask him a question?
Oh my God. He would laugh at me because I was so neurotic about it. I'd go to his house and I'm like, Milton, what am I doing with my life? You know? But no, I mean, there's a couple projects that I'm producing right now. One in particular that I'm so excited about that I'm developing the story, producing, and will also be in. And it's a genre I've never been a part of that I've been always wanted to do. And I so wish I could give him that script and ask him for guidance and help, because the what it will take for me to act in this film, it is so I don't know what I'm thinking, but it's something that I've never done before, and I don't know how I'm going to do it. I really don't know if I can even pull it off. I'm really terrified.
Yeah.
And I wish he was around to talk to and coach me, and, you know.
And that's how you know it's the right project, though. You know, if it's something
Rajiv,
that you're like, I'm not sure if I can do that.
Either going to be the laughing stock of the world, or I really don't know what I'm thinking. It's insane.
I've been writing a one-person show for a little over a year, and I was working on it again with somebody yesterday who's helping me out with it. And it's the same feeling I have right now where I've been writing it and it's written. It's just now, like, you know, like they say, you're trying to find the David within that, you know, that piece, within that sculpture. But I mean, I really feel like it's one of those things. I mean, it's going to be a one person show. I'm going to perform it, you know, live and all that. And it's going to be probably 85 to 90 minutes long, and we're not going to do an intermission, and we're just going to go. And, I've written it, and I know, once we whittle it, because I did a reading here in this room, where I had about 15 people come out, and I did a reading of it. I had to do it in two different nights. It was 3.5 hours long. That is whittled down. I cut 50% of it to that. So when I take this 3.5 hours, and I whittle it down to 85 minutes, I know it's gonna be like,
it's going to be the killer material.
Yeah, and then it's a question then of, can I bring it to life?
You can, because you wrote it.
I hope so, yeah.
It'll be great.
I hope so.
It's going to be great.
But you're right, there is that risk of, like,
and by the way, having so much material is an amazing problem to have, by the way. To have such that you don't know what to cut, you're not going to make a bad decision, because you have all good stuff.
Sure.
It's about picking the stuff. And it probably will be you needing to work them out.
Right.
And figure out which one feels best for you. Yes. And at the end of the day, the thing you're going to cut is the one that you're like, I'm not really connecting to this.
Yeah.
And that'll be the stuff that you end up losing.
It's the same thing with stand-up, because you have those feelings on certain days when you know you're going to perform, and you're like, I can't wait to tell them this joke.
Right.
And if you don't have any of your jokes that you're excited to tell them, you've got the wrong set.
Yeah.
Or you're not writing enough.
Yeah.
Like, I mean, even if you've got 20 jokes,
and you might
change
your mind. Like, you might do it and you think, by the way, there's things that you think are going to be great, and then
right.
you're like, oh, I guess that didn't work so much.
Right,
and that's okay. Yeah. Well, that's the process.
Sure.
That's why having more material is a blessing.
It's great.
Yeah.
It's very lucky to be, I'm very lucky to be prolific, but then it's good to see how good it is. What are some of the funniest movies you've ever seen?
You know, it's funny. I have a hard time with these lists. But I will tell you, I'm more of a, like, instead of picking movies, because I love a lot of movies, but I would say, like, I'm much more a fan of certain, like, comedians. Like, I love Steve Martin. I love so I'll say I like any of their movies, probably. Like, I love Albert Brooks, obviously, so being able to work with him was, like, a dream.
Sure.
Because Defending Your Life is one of my all-time favorite movies, period.
Great.
But Steve Martin is amazing. I love Tootsie. I love Dustin Hall. I love Bill Murray. I mean, Bill Murray is amazing. Who else? I love...
Bill Murray has said that for all the people out there who want to be rich and famous, find out if rich covers it. Because when you become famous, he's like, when you become famous, you end up with a 24-hour-a-day job.
Oh, my God.
Yeah,
I love it. No,
it's amazing.
Awesome.
It's good advice.
That's funny. No, I have I love old Monty Python movies.
Yeah.
John Candy. I'm a big... So for Planes, Trains, and Automobiles.
It's really
you
one
know,
of the
there's certain, like... I'm an oldie when it comes to stuff like that.
But to me, the best comedy movies were made in the 80s.
Yes.
So, I mean, to me, the best music was from the 60s. The best comedy movies from the 80s. The best dramatic movies for me were the 70s. So I'm very much like a...
an
era-based person.
That's funny. You say, yeah, I guess.
And I could defend that against, like, if people are like, all right, bring it, I'd be like, I'll tell you what.
Yeah, we could get into some debates about all of that.
I love to make these really strong statements when people go,
I'm much more of a fan of, like, actors because I feel like putting them in anything would be enjoyable. Whether I love the movie or not, I'm not so sure. But I love watching people, like I said, do what they do best. You know.
Well, then, I mean, you're a Howard Stern fan.
Yes, I love him. And you don't listen to him.
I never have, and it's just not because I don't like him.
As a comedian, I don't know why you wouldn't.
I just have never gotten around to it for whatever reason. Sell me on why I should listen to Howard Stern.
Well, first of all, he is, in my opinion, beyond brilliant. There are a lot of people that I would put in that category.
Okay.
But...
Meryl Streep and Howard Stern.
Yes, perfect. Perfect thing in a row. Those two deserve to be in the same sentence, which I would argue, by the way. And I'll tell you why.
Tell me what.
Because Howard Stern created... By the way, I blame him. And if I ever get on his show, I already know our conversation that we're going to have with him on his show. Because I listen to him every day, which is why I'm terrified to be on his show. Because I know what he would
do.
Oh, even on repeats. Oh, yeah. No, Rajiv, I am... A diehard.
Wow.
You ask me about Howard Stern trivia, I will rival people. Like, it is no joke. I've been listening to him for that long. And there's a club. I will tell you, when I meet another Howard Stern fan who's a genuine fan, not just someone who says because they want to feel cool.
Yeah.
There is a club that I immediately like them because to love Howard Stern, number one, tells me you don't take yourself too seriously.
Okay.
That you have a sense of humor.
Uh-huh.
That you can laugh and not be like so freaking uptight about things.
Sure, sure.
And outside of all of that, he is actually so smart and people don't realize how sensitive and generous he is. And talk about what he did. What I'm going to get back to is I blame him for the reality world that we have now. Because he started it. Back when he started, what he honed into is he realized all the other stuff wasn't working.
Sure.
And he decided, you know what, I'm just going to go on air and be myself. I'm going to be honest and tell stories about my life. And that's what he is. He started that. Without him, I don't think we would have half of the stuff. It would have come later. I don't know when it would have came. But he's the one who started doing the real life stories, reality, anything. And now when you look at TV, radio shows or anything, they're very much all trying to be a Howard Stern.
Sure.
They are. I mean, I just think he has created something that is so significant in so many ways. I love the fact that he is a bit of an outcast.
Mm-hmm.
I love that he's never felt like he fit in.
Mm-hmm.
I feel very much like he never has gotten the proper respect that he deserves. I think he certainly earned it. I love that he makes that much money. I think he earned every penny of it.
$500 million?
Well, there's a difference, but he makes a lot of money. He's fine. But I think he's earned every freaking penny of it because he actually, like me, worked I'm not calling myself as smart as him, but he worked his ass off. And when you know where he came from and he made, like, $90 a week, he earned it, you know?
Well,
and he came
Chris
in
Rock
there
says.
Creating...
Yeah.
Chris Rock is a huge fan of Howard. Yeah. When you see, when you hear Chris Rock and Howard, because Chris Rock's one of my favorites, it is gold. When you hear... Chris Rock gives... Because now he's in... He just renewed for 5 years, and he's doing shows, but he's doing less shows.
Okay.
And because he wasn't going to come back, but he didn't want to retire completely.
This is Stern.
Yeah. So he just renewed in the beginning of this year.
Okay.
And so he's doing... Like, sometimes a week off, and he'll do a week, and instead of doing 4 days, he'll do 3 days. So he's cut down a bit, but he's still around.
Right.
And re-signed for 5 years. And Chris is so funny. He's like, when you're not off relaxing, because I need to put you on, and I agree with him, because as much as I know Howard deserves it, I miss him.
Right.
And when he had off this week, I'm like, oh, it's a fucking repeat. It's a freak. I don't get to hear a new Howard, and I want to hear what he thinks about the world.
Right.
His take on politics is amazing to me. Like, I can't wait to sit there and just dish, because I actually agree with him a lot, shockingly enough, because I am a very, like... You know, I'm a woman that believes in women in everything. And a lot of people believe that he's a, you know, sadomasochistic, whatever you want to call it. I do not at all. He loves women.
Sure.
And so it's people always look at me from what they think of me, and they have an idea of who I am, which a lot of people don't. They're like, really? You like Howard Stern? I'm like, yeah. You listen to him, and if you like him, you and I are going to be buddies.
That's funny.
Because I have a lot of friends that don't listen to him, by the way, and it's fine, but my few...
You don't have to get into this.
You don't have to, but I have a few friends that are love him like me, and we constantly... Did you hear that? Did you hear that? He just had Lady Gaga on. By the way, he has everyone from Paul McCartney on to Chris Rock to Seinfeld, Lady Gaga,
you name it.
But the fact is, a lot of people are scared of him, and they won't go on, and I think you have the balls to go on Howard Stern, and you can roll with him.
Mm-hmm.
I like you.
Mm-hmm.
Lady Gaga is obviously a phenomenon and insanely talented, but I couldn't tell if I actually liked her as like a person, because I couldn't tell. Not that she has to tell me who she is, but I wasn't sure.
Sure.
She won on Howard Stern. She did maybe an hour and a half, maybe more, and then did a live performance. I adore that woman. She was so honest. He gets you, which is why I'm nervous, right, because I'm so private about so much.
Right.
He gets you to talk about stuff and be honest in a way that no one else does. He cuts through the BS. He's an amazing interviewer. He is a genius. And I don't know what I'll do when he's done it, because I think in 5 years, I think he's going to be done now. But I adore him. I'm the biggest champion of Howard Stern. Really?
Wow. I've never heard anyone speak that way about a lot of folks, but about Howard Stern.
I think he's amazing.
And there's been no reason I haven't listened to him. I just haven't. I've always been fascinated about the fact that he can put on beyond for hours a day.
By the way, and that's what's funny, is that people give him crap, right? Who do you know that can go on for 4, sometimes 5 hours,
hours a day,
4 days a week,
mm-hmm.
and still have content and be interesting?
The reason is, because I do a lot of personal branding work, whatever, it can't just be that he's telling jokes. You have to be bought into him.
No, he's not.
And if
he's
you're bought
just,
into
he's
him,
just talking.
Then you
he's,
can do that.
He created this thing of let's be myself.
Sure.
And then, you know, he has writers and they have things to talk about. He talks about current state of affairs. He talks about, he has guests, he has interviews, he has bits, and by the way, I don't love every one of his bits.
Sure.
I
love Chris Rock. I don't love every joke he ever
did. There's not everyone that they're like, you liked that too? I'm like, no, I didn't. But I don't like everything everyone does, and I'm okay with that. And I'll just be like, okay, I'll be back in 10 minutes, you know?
It's all good.
Because some things I don't find funny.
Right.
And it's not up my alley. But most, you can't find that about anyone, but mostly, I am on par, and I'm so want to be on his show, but so nervous too that I don't know what I'd ever do if it actually happens.
That's pretty awesome.
Yeah.
Wow, very, very cool. I don't know. Now I'm thinking of myself as an interviewer. I'm like, what do I need to do to be like Howard Stern? What questions do I need to ask?
Listen to him.
Listen to Howard Stern. It's a Stern warning. What could you give up most easily, and what would be the hardest to give up? Books, TV, music, or movies?
What would be the hardest to
give
up, or the easiest to give up?
And what would be the easiest out of those? Music?
Well, I don't think I'd give up. I mean, I will tell you that books, music, TV, or movies?
Yeah. What would be the easiest?
Easiest to give up? God, I don't think I'd give up any of those. Here's the thing. The thing that I need the most is probably music.
Okay.
Because that's just everywhere with me.
Sure.
Books are amazing. I love reading, and a lot of great movies come from books.
Sure,
so
sure.
That is inherent. And TV, I love TV. I love the like quick,
right?
You know, that it's in your living room, that it's accessible to so many.
Mm-hmm.
You know, there's so many things and pros and cons about both. That I'm not answering the question.
That's good. But you said, it sounds like music would be the hardest to give up.
Yeah, because that's something that, I mean, I just can't. Mm-hmm. I go to sleep with music on.
What do you listen to?
I mean, it's just, when I sleep, it's a very different thing than when I, during the day.
Okay. But what do you sleep to?
What I sleep to is usually, like, cheesy, slow, you know, everything from Sade to Simon and Garfunkel to John Lennon to the Beatles. It just depends. I have a mix of things. It depends on my mood. But I like really all music. I love, love country. I love hip-hop. I love...
That sums it up. When people say they love country and hip-hop, that kind of
Yeah, no, I'm
everything.
Really a fan. I just love music. I love, like I said, I love anything good. So if I can... I love good music, so, and it's subjective, of course. Right now, like currently, I love Adele. Like, she is my obsession
right
now.
She's like the thing these days.
She is unbelievable.
Yeah.
That song, Rolling in the Deep, which I know everyone loves, but the lyrics of that song are so brilliant. I love her.
Yeah, no, she's
And I respect someone who creates their own stuff and plays their own instruments and writes their own songs.
Well, that's the producer in you.
Yes.
Yeah, absolutely.
I just feel like that just tells me a lot about, you know, where it comes from.
What pisses you off?
Oh, a lot. Don't get me started.
I can see that. That's probably the last question I'll have to ask.
Gosh, like, I could go on and on and on.
I heard somebody say recently that people who are pissed off about politics are actually just angry people, and they're choosing politics to get mad about.
No, I see, for me, that would probably fall into, it would be a toss-up between apathy and entitlement. Are probably my...
I don't care about apathy.
Twist. Well, I do, because... Well, yeah, I get what you did there. It took me a second.
I see what you did there. Apathy and entitlement?
And entitlement are probably the two that irk me the most. I'll tell you why. Entitlement is insanely... It ties into arrogance, it ties into selfishness, it ties into narcissism. I mean, you get me started, and I see it in my business all the time, and I want to... I'll go off on a tangent.
Right.
The squeaky wheel gets the oil mentality. Drives me crazy.
Right.
I think you should fire people who have horrible attitudes, don't show up prepared, show up late, and I find it so much. I don't know why you're like, oh, whatever you need, sir, madam, whatever. I think it's horrible that we reward it.
Yeah.
And we just want them to stop, so we'll give them what they want. Yeah. I think it's bad behavior, and we should never... And it goes into when I was bartending, and there'd be people who would complain. And if there was a legitimate complaint, I'd be the first one to be like, oh my God, of course, I'll take care of it. So I'm extremely fair. And when it comes to ethic and more at like the right thing, I will go to my grave knowing that I'm fair.
And that's hard because this is not a merit-based industry.
Which is why,
be fair.
See why I'm going losing my mind?
Yeah.
But so I'd be working that. And so you'd have managers that'd be like, this person, just give them a drink, tell them to shut up. I'm like, you know what? Why don't I buy a drink for the really nice couple at the end that is lovely and would never complain and be like, you know, I'm so sorry, and didn't, when something actually legitimately happened and they don't ask for anything. Why don't we reward that behavior? Mm-hmm. And I feel like we live in a society that is the squeaky wheel gets the oil, and it makes me crazy. And I don't think you should reward any kind of bad behavior. I don't. So that is where that all comes into. And then when it comes to apathy, and that's part of me being someone that's involved. And obviously people can get involved in different ways and different levels. It doesn't have to be fully and certainly, but take a freaking interest. People who don't vote, by the way, I could never marry someone that doesn't vote. It's a deal breaker for me.
Right on.
It's like one of those things where you don't have to know about everything, but you have to care. And then, because the people who complain about everything are the first people who don't vote or don't have an opinion or don't take an interest to learn about one thing. It makes me crazy.
It's interesting because this is a conversation that I kind of need to hear, or a point of view that I need to hear. I used to be very politically involved. And I didn't vote in the 2010 election. And that's the very first time.
You said that I don't like either of them.
I voted in 2008. I voted for Obama. But in 2010, it was the first time I had not voted since I was 18. I believe that's the case. And because I was always like, vote. But now I think I'm in this swing, and I think life is a pendulum. I'm in this swing right now where I'm like, it doesn't matter. It doesn't matter.
But imagine if everyone felt that way.
Well, but they don't. And so that's my counter-argument. So,
no, but a lot of them do. But, and there's more people that believe that than you would imagine.
I think that...
Because they believe someone else will do it, or someone else will take care of it.
They will.
No, but they won't. Not the way you would want to, right? If you want someone else to do it...
But if I vote or not, they still won't listen to me.
Yeah, but they will. That's the thing. Is like, the fact of the matter is, power in numbers matters, and if everyone would actually get up off their, you know, whatever...
So that's what we did.
And do it.
We elected Obama.
Mm-hmm.
We put him in the office.
Right.
And he's like every other president.
No, I don't agree with that.
Okay, explain. Sell me on why he's not.
Well, first of all, talking about Obama is like a whole other thing and what's happening, but I will tell you, first, like, there's so many tangents right now going on in my head.
I love it. Just go. I love it.
Because I have so many things to, like, talk about why the political system is failing and why it's not even working. But I will start by saying that I am not a fan of a two-party system, period.
Sure.
I am not a fan of watching television and people even saying and reinforcing Democrat and Republican. I want names. Mm-hmm. I would rather them say, so-and-so says this, so-and-so says that. So you know who they're talking about, mm-hmm. because I do not believe that all those groups believe any of those things. Mm-hmm. And I think that we should be focusing on what keeps us, what we have in common, than what's divisive. And I think that the news culture and the media actually divides us by even saying things like that.
Sure.
I think it's horrendous. And I would love if we were in a country that actually voted in the top two, that had the final be the top two people that they cared about, and who care what party they came from, because frankly, no one believes in everything these parties stand for, period.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm a registered independent and proud to be. It's funny, because when I was in New York, I don't know if that's changed now, but there are some states where you can't vote in the primaries unless you're a registered thing, and that irritates me. I think that's
still very
BS.
True for a lot of states.
But when I came to California, you can, so I switched to being an independent again, because I'm like, at least that's who I am.
Mm-hmm.
But I needed to, so, like, that's how crazy I get. But when it comes to Obama, I feel like, I do think that he needs to lead in a much stronger way, but I'm more just really saddened by the fact that it's so obvious that there's so much political maneuvering that's happening that nothing can get done. And there's so much posturing. You have, what's her name? Christine O'Donnell, is that her name?
Or is it the one from New Jersey.
Did you see her on Piers Morgan recently?
Oh, yeah, where she stormed out.
And I thought to myself,
and I didn't think his questions were that crazy.
By the way, first of all, I don't think any question is off limits if you're in the public. If you're a politician and you're in the public arena, there are certain jobs where I think that certain things are off limits. Mm-hmm. But when you're an elected official, I feel I have a right to know everything I want to know.
Mm-hmm.
You can answer it however you want, but there is nothing I shouldn't be able to ask, mm-hmm. because I'm voting you in and you're supposed to represent me. So your thoughts, including personal, will tell me something about your character, which at the end of the day matter in that office. I think certain professions don't, but in this one it does. So I don't think, and by the way, that was ridiculous because she actually wrote about it in her book.
Yeah, he's like, what about, for the people who don't know, she was on Piers Morgan. I don't think it aired because it was on YouTube.
He's aired it the next day, aired it and then talked about it.
Oh, just showed
it.
Okay, yeah. Okay, got that. And she refused to answer a question he asked her about gay marriage, which apparently...
It started with him asking her about the comments she made about sex.
Okay.
How she was saying that masturbation was bad, and how can you do that without lust in your heart, talking about the Bible and all that stuff. And then she was upset about that. And then he said, okay, well, what about gay marriage? And she said, can we not talk about that? And he's like, well, you talk about it in your book.
Did you watch Louis on FX? Louis C.K.'s show is by far the most brilliant show on TV. I'll say that without ever even seeing it on TV. I saw that thing...
Did Chris Rock? Oh, Seinfeld. Was it Chris Rock, Seinfeld, Louis C.K., and Ricky
still
Gervais?
I still have that
Ricky
on
Gervais
my DVR.
I love Ricky Gervais. Yeah.
He's the funniest person ever walked the
planet.
That's what I feel.
So
I love
tell
Gervais.
Me about Louis.
So Louis, who was on Talking Funny, that HBO special that you just brought up, he has his own show on FX, and he's the only person in the business to have full creative control. In other words, FX does not see it until we see it.
Oh my God.
Until it airs.
Wow.
He writes it, directs it, produces it. It's called the Louis deal. He just goes, I'm not going to do a show unless I get this. And they gave it to him. And he wasn't a dick about it, apparently. He just said, I have a vision for a show.
Well,
I don't want to be watered down.
I'm going to DVR that because that's exciting.
I've got four or five of them and I've on DVR. I've watched them three times each. The first season was hit or miss. He was finding his voice, finding his way.
Mm-hmm.
But the second season has just been absolutely brilliant. And every episode is different from the last, and you're just, like, amazed at this guy. So how did we get on Louis?
We were talking about Piers Morgan. Christine, politics,
yeah, and so
funny.
One of his episodes that Louis did was he had himself in the show on Fox News with, I think, Greg Gutfeld, the red-eyed guy from Fox News. And it was Louis, and then this woman who was she was Christians Against Masturbation.
Well, that's like, what's her name?
Well, and it's very true to life.
Yeah.
And then when Louis C.K. came on and they had the banner, it said Louis C.K., comedian/masturbator. And so he got the whole thing
see,
on. He
see,
just
you
right
love it. By the way, you love Howard Stern.
Howard Stern.
You're going to love Howard Stern.
It's and I love that kind of thing because it's just
Howard.
It's very ironic and it's very just poking fun at it, but it's still very real.
But speaking of, I'm going to go off on a Howard tangent. Howard's so great. Like he'll go out. He'll have people go out into the street, and do polls, and they'll say, "Who do you hate more? Howard Stern, Octomom," you know, and he'll do these things. Mm-hmm. And it's always Howard Stern.
Right. Right.
And he'll talk about this, and he'll be like, "How do people hate me so much?"
Right. Right.
And he'll do it even like
right.
Howard Stern and Hitler. Howard Stern and whatever. He'll do like the worst people ever.
Yeah, and he'll be on it.
And it's shocking. It's hysterical because you're like, this is the image people have of him, and he doesn't... I mean, he gets it, but he doesn't really believe it.
Right.
And we're all like, I mean, it's funny because he's the first person, which is why, like I said, you cannot take yourself too
right.
seriously.
Right.
And he'll be the first person to call right. himself out on stuff.
Right.
And be the first one to say, you know what, I crossed the line, or I didn't, or whatever.
Uh-huh.
And he's softened over the years. He had three daughters, which is,
sure.
I think, like, God's way of being like, Howard.
Absolutely. No, that God has a way of doing that.
Yeah.
Well, we should have a whole show just on politics. You and I could chop it up.
We probably could.
I'm very, like, not involved as much as aware, and I watch the news,
yes.
and I've read, and I
well,
feel like I...
Well, that's exciting enough for me.
I feel like I know, I feel like I know my stuff.
Yeah.
And I think that's always, it's always
have you been on Bill Maher's show?
I haven't. I want to be on it. I was telling you, I think, about Reggie Brown, who did this show 3 days after he did Maher. And he said, "You have a standing invitation to come with me to go see it
you
anytime you want." I should totally go. I watch Bill Maher every single week.
Yes.
So he to me is probably Howard Stern.
Yeah,
and you.
I love Bill Maher too, by the way.
That's great. I mean, I love.
Did you see him on Piers Morgan?
I saw that
yeah.
episode. He was always on Larry King.
Yes.
And he was on my friend Monrock, who did this show because she slept with him, so it's fine. I'm not making that up. What's the least attractive quality in a person?
Well, it would go into the stuff.
Is it entitlement? Entitlement
be,
and apathy?
It'd be, yeah, it'd be all, like,
okay.
that, all the stuff I just ranted about, yeah.
What are a few words to describe you?
That I would describe myself, people would describe me.
Okay, so talk about it. Is there a difference?
I don't know. I mean, I think people who are close to me in my,
sure.
like, close group would probably agree. Because
sure.
I own my stuff, you know.
Sure.
I own that I am bossy.
Sure.
I know I am.
Okay.
I know that I'm...
Well, I have an entitlement attitude, so we should get along well. Yeah, I'm very open about it. I actually did an interview with someone, and I admitted... I just said it. I was like, and I have an entitlement mentality. And she goes, "No one admits that. You freely... And you're proud of it." And I go, yeah.
Well, that's, by the way, that will tell me that you actually don't.
Yeah.
That's why I should be okay with it. Because someone
that's
who
true.
Says it, there's no way you do.
Yeah, that's true.
Bossy,
mm-hmm.
insanely honest,
okay,
to a fault,
okay,
really sensitive.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, I'm a hard ass, and I'm a tough chick, but my heart is as soft as
mm-hmm.
they come. So
mm-hmm.
I'm, and I think everyone in my close
mm-hmm.
circle would agree
mm-hmm.
to all of that. I mean, I get that I am sometimes, you know, extremely opinionated
mm-hmm.
and bossy and need control,
mm-hmm.
et cetera, et cetera.
Mm-hmm.
But at the end of the day, I'm so fair
right.
and so honest
right.
and so just sensitive
right.
and loving that
right.
I think that
right.
it's from the right place.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
So those are...
I like that. And would people say the same about you?
I think anyone in my who knows me, yes, I do.
Mm-hmm.
I do
what about people who don't know you?
I don't know what people think of me. I think that...
Do you care?
No.
Okay.
It's impossible to
okay.
be who I am and care.
Uh-huh.
I can't.
Uh-huh.
I don't. First of all, I don't even take myself that seriously.
Sure. Well, that's why you like Howard Stern.
Yeah, exactly. I don't, and by the way, I've been under fire my whole life.
Sure.
From growing up for other reasons to then doing the movies that I do
mm-hmm.
and being extremely opinionated about
mm-hmm.
stuff. We didn't even get to the whole, like, South Asian stuff, which I'm glad because I will go off on a whole other rant about that.
I gotta watch you
so
now. Yeah. Maybe I'll have you on again.
I have very... You know, I say things that people are annoyed with a lot
uh-huh.
of times.
Say and something that people will be annoyed with.
I don't know. It just comes out. It's not...
Come on, you set it up so well.
I'm trying to
you can't take me to
right
the cliff
now.
And then...
I'm just
try,
I don't know. I'm trying to think of stuff. I'm trying to give you something.
Sure.
But I will tell you that I get hate mail as much as I get fan mail. Well, not
really?
As much. I get more fan mail. But I get a lot of hate mail. I do.
What's the last piece of hate mail that registered with you?
The stuff that affects me, because I normally don't care, because
sure.
I feel like my integrity and my heart is intact.
Sure.
I have no issue there.
So it's more about your work?
But yes.
Okay.
But the thing that then a little bit will make me a little nervous is when it's so emotional and personal,
mm-hmm.
because those are the ones that will go out and blow up a building.
Mm-hmm.
You know, when
mm-hmm.
you can tell there's a little
mm-hmm.
bit of something off. It's one thing to not like my movies or
mm-hmm.
like me as an actor or like me as a perfect. I don't care.
Mm-hmm.
I would love you to, but it's okay.
Mm-hmm.
And honestly, I've always said this from the very beginning. I don't want to be in movies that don't have a strong reaction.
Sure.
I would rather you love them or hate them.
Well, the worst thing is indifference.
Right. The mediocrity, which I talk about.
Absolutely.
You know, so
absolutely.
I'm okay with not liking my work or me being a part of certain movies, but when it gets like really personal and it's like physical harm and things that people have said to me, that's a little unnerving, mm-hmm, you know, mm-hmm. And I've gotten a little bit of that. Mm-hmm. I mean, I get it. I'll take the fire, and I love a debate. I mean, I love a debate.
Sure.
And I will hold my own. I can sit there, and I love discussions like this. I love anything. Mm-hmm. And I'd love a really intelligent conversation. But some of the hate mail is a bit disturbing.
Mm-hmm.
Because it's about intolerance. It's usually about hate, mm-hmm. like about like groups of people,
right,
and people,
right.
And that's just scary and mm-hmm. sad to me. Mm-hmm. It's like what Natalie Maines talk about it in the song, in the documentary Shut Up and Sing. It started because she made a comment about a political opinion she had, and people were like, just shut up and sing or I'm going to kill you. And that's unbelievable to me. Like, they
yeah.
actually meant it, you know?
Yeah.
And
But
that's what I mean, is like, I'm like thinking, wow, mm-hmm. okay. And I've gotten a little bit of that, but it's okay. I'll take it. I feel like I can't not live my life.
Sure.
And I don't care. I'm a little bit like, wow, those people, I hate that they exist in the world, but mm-hmm. I know they do. Mm-hmm. And I just hope that the more I do what I do, that will hopefully soften
sure.
or change. Because I can
sure.
only keep doing what I'm doing.
Oh, absolutely.
Yeah.
Well, no, you could quit and you're not.
No, I would
yeah.
never. It could
I mean,
never.
Well, I mean, give yourself credit. I mean, it's like you can only do, you could just be like, all right. But
I mean,
the fact that you go on.
I mean,
is,
I was in
is,
a movie called ABCD, which was probably the very first
one of the
dealing
first.
With anything having
right.
to do with the South Asian experience.
Yeah.
And it was a drama dealing with a character that people didn't like. They felt like, you're finally talking about our experiences and you're playing, I don't know if you saw it, but I was a promiscuous girl
right,
who was
right.
struggling
uh-huh.
and people hated it. People hated me. People came up to me and like, I remember this one guy, like, threw a pack of cigarettes at me and gave me a whole lecture. And then, I mean, they thought I was that girl. Which, by the way, I am so protective of her and don't think she's any of those things.
The character.
And, yes. Uh-huh. But people thought, whatever they thought of her, mm-hmm. they thought I was that girl and treated me as such.
Mm-hmm.
Especially at the time when there weren't people
well, you're right,
doing
right,
it.
Right,
so
right.
they're like, oh, my God. You're supposed to be our, like, they felt like I should be representing
ambassador,
them.
Ambassador, the representative.
Right.
right,
and so they weren't happy with what I chose,
right.
you know.
And you're not an elected official. I mean, you're not the senior
Ronald.
So.
However, I will, like I said, I will defend any of my choices mm-hmm. down to my grave because I feel fine with them.
So you talk a lot about the people that you started with.
Mm-hmm.
So who were that core group of people where you go, wow, they were the real pioneers in
yeah,
the South Asian.
I would say, well, like Asif Manvi,
sure.
Cal.
Mm-hmm.
Sarita Chowdhury,
mm-hmm.
Deep, you mm-hmm. know, was around.
Kathir,
yes. Who else? I'm trying to think of the people that, when I started, were the only ones that I knew, really.
Mm-hmm. That's a good list, though.
Yeah, yeah.
Most of them were New York-based at the time.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, pretty much.
And now it seems like it's shifted to L.A.
A little bit. There's still, mm-hmm. like, Asif still lives in New York. Mm-hmm. I mean,
But he's got a gig on The Daily Show. So
right,
he's
but he lived
there
even, like, he
sure.
still lives there.
Sure.
I go back and forth.
Mm-hmm.
Deep's in New York. Mm-hmm. I don't know if he's still acting, though. But
I don't think he's doing as much. But
right,
yeah.
I think he's mm-hmm. doing a little bit of everything. Right? I think he's producing, actually,
mm-hmm.
and acting,
mm-hmm.
which is great. Mm-hmm. You know, Cal's coming back. And
yeah, he came back
you know,
with the Obama administration.
So
because Obama
this,
sucks.
No, he doesn't
I'm kidding,
suck.
I'm just trying to rile you.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
But no. But he came back for Harold and Kumar 3.
Yeah, and he's got a deal with NBC, and, you know, so, I mean, I think everyone's just, I think the great thing about what we're doing is that
right.
none of us are the same.
Sure.
And the problem is, like, this industry tries to lump us together like
no,
we are.
No, that's very true.
And actually, all the women that I might be up against on a con, we're so different.
That's true.
That at the end of the day, if one of us gets it, I feel like, well, there's an obvious reason because there's a certain quality about
mm-hmm.
all of us that's quite different.
Mm-hmm.
And so, just like in any other ethnicity, everyone kind of finds their own thing. And
mm-hmm.
what I'm doing is completely, I don't know anyone else who's done the kind of stuff that I've done to the certain, like, for the longevity and
mm-hmm.
the type of movies
mm-hmm.
and the range of characters mm-hmm. that I've been so fortunate to have, but I haven't done what the other people have
mm-hmm.
done. I haven't done the amazing things that they've done. It's
mm-hmm.
we all have our own way. And
what's
that's
your
fun.
Thing? Like, what's your you know when because you have done you are unique. How would you define it?
I would say my thing is really like I don't want to repeat myself.
Mm-hmm.
So for me as an actor, what's fun about it is exploring something new. So
mm-hmm.
I don't feel like anything I've ever played is the same that I've done.
Mm-hmm.
Like
we were talking about looking for comedy in the Muslim world all the way to
right,
the veil.
But I mean,
entirely different roles.
Right. I mean, and everything in between, too,
mm-hmm.
was completely
mm-hmm.
different, you know. And just this year alone,
mm-hmm.
I did a New Age movie where I play a neurologist. It's a sci-fi thing. To going to a full-out sex comedy swinger
mm-hmm.
to, you know, three veil.
Writer. You played a writer.
Yeah, exactly.
Mm-hmm.
So I just love to do that,
mm-hmm.
you know.
Mm-hmm.
The World Unseen, which was kind of a big cult movie. I played, it was a period piece in South Africa from mm-hmm. the 50s. Mm-hmm. I loved that. I did a movie in London where I play a British girl and I can't think straight, you know, mm-hmm. struggling with her own sexuality.
Sure.
You know, I've had some really great opportunities to really just be an actor.
Mm-hmm.
So I feel really lucky.
That's fantastic.
Yeah. And then the stuff that I'm producing is completely...
Three Veils. You've got a couple other projects. I don't know.
Yes, and I have a movie called Rain. It's mm-hmm. a short, but I co-produced it, and it's amazing. It's a it's about war and the human side of it, if there is, you know, whatever you want to call the side of it.
Sure.
And Kimberly Jensen wrote and directed it, and the script just blew me away again, and so much so that it got great people. Jack Green, who is... Oscar-nominated mm-hmm. Clint Eastwood's DP from mm-hmm. The Unforgiven and several mm-hmm. other movies, came and was our DP and brought David McMillan, Oscar winner. His whole crew came because he loved the script. And so I play this refugee that has an encounter with these Marines and it ends it's a whole tragic thing. But it's so powerful, and we have amazing crew that did it for us. Mm-hmm. And like I said, I co-produced it, and I'm so proud. And, you know, just finished, so we're now like... Mm-hmm. going to start its thing. Mm-hmm. And then these other projects that are still in script phases, but completely different. Mm-hmm. So I'm really happy that I've been
That's
able to
great.
Do things. Yeah.
That's fantastic.
Yeah.
Well, I'll wrap up with one question, and then we'll call it. Because
okay.
If you'll indulge me with coming back at some point,
right,
I'd love to have you back again. We have so many other questions that we didn't get to, but it's
I keep talking to him.
It's a tribute to the conversation we've had. I think that's a good thing. So, what would it mean to pull a U? I love to ask people this question.
I mean, definitely calling someone out, maybe
uh-huh.
in not the right appropriate time.
Okay, I like that. That's a good one.
That
ties into your intensely honest.
Yeah, yeah. I, you know, and I hate BS.
Mm-hmm.
And I hate that.
You like to cut to the chase.
Yeah, I'm like, really? That's not what you mean at all. Like,
yeah.
I'll be the first one to say something,
right.
maybe put my... The thing is, so I struggle because I am very sensitive. I don't want to mm-hmm. ever hurt... I'm not looking to hurt anyone's feelings
sure,
or certainly
sure.
embarrass anyone. I'm not, but I also want a real conversation, so...
I will say that with stand-up, I'll say, I don't mind if I offend, I don't want to hurt.
Right,
because
exactly.
you offend someone's mind, you hurt someone's heart.
Exactly.
And I think
and by the way, my existence could offend someone.
Sure,
you know,
sure.
so there's nothing I can do about
There's nothing you can do about it. Well, yeah, there is, but
I don't know.
Right.
But I don't want to hurt anyone's feelings.
Right,
because
right, right.
I believe in everyone's having their own idea
sure.
of everything.
Sure.
Except if it's hateful and intolerant. But,
mm-hmm. Well, even those people are in pain.
And what I'm saying is
reason,
I don't necessarily
right.
want to have...
You don't need to indulge it.
No, I'll indulge it if we're having an intelligent conversation,
right,
but
right.
I don't want to give them a platform where they get to
of
spew
course.
Hate.
Well, it ties back into what you're saying about rewarding bad behavior.
Yes.
I mean, why the squeaky can if somebody's going to scream or throw cigarettes at you? You
right.
know, it's just like...
Or
you
come
to
set completely unprofessionally.
Right, right.
And because they're who they are, mm-hmm. I'm like, wow.
Yeah. Yeah,
I don't like
sad.
It.
No, that's the kind of entitlement that I think none of us likes.
Right, but you call yourself that, so.
I'm not that kind of entitlement. I'm not that kind of entitlement. I'm a whole different kind of entitlement.
No, I know you're not because you just said
yeah.
like it's impossible.
No, that's.
And
good.
I can smell it.
You can smell it. You can tell.
So
that's just my feet. But
I like to say to get people riled
up. I love it. I love it. It's very provocative. Thank you very much for joining.
Thank you. I can't believe it's been an hour.
That segment alone was 57 minutes.
Oh my god.
Plus the 30 we just did.
Oh goodness. Sorry, guys.
That's a good sign when it feels like it was shorter. If you're
yeah,
like, God, I've been
forever.
Here for four
yeah.
hours. In the heat, too.
Yes.
We're in the valley.
It's been very hot.
When the window's up and we turned off the air so that we could
hear.
We've
both taken off all of our clothes at this point. You guys haven't seen it, but we've actually stripped through every question because we're dying of heat.
That's what we were doing between section one and section two. Now you've answered
yeah.
it, so there you go. Thank you very much for joining on the Funny Indian Show podcast, episode 58, also known as the Tangent Show. This has been Sheetal Sheth. We want to make sure we get that right, which you did from the beginning. And you can check her out at SheetalSheth.com, which is SheetalSheth. You can also find her on the same handle at Twitter.
Yes.
And you can Google or look for her, I guess. I guess Mark Zuckerberg wouldn't like it if we called it Google on Facebook. But you can look for her, search for her on Facebook, and it's whichever fan page has the most
yes.
people, most fans.
You'll be able to tell which
You'll
one
be able
right.
to tell
yeah.
which one it is. So you can have an adventure with that. Thank you for joining us. I've been your host, Rajiv, and I still am.
Ha ha.